to go to the next election. And the polling that our party, and I'm sure Labor do, is a hell of a lot more healthier, but it is what it is.
There you go. That's Shane Jones talking about the latest poll, which has got New Zealand First on four, National doing quite well. Let's bring in our panel, Professor Jennifer Curtin, Business New Zealand's Chief Executive Kirk Hope, and Gisborne Mayor Ming Foon. Good evening to you all. Jennifer, if we start with that poll result, probably a little bit of a surprise, do you think, to see National sort of back to that sort of 46 number?
Well, I think because we also had that other poll between the two Colmar-Brunton ones that suggested National had dropped to 37.
Mm, just after the Jamie Lee Roth sort of scandal,
yeah,
wasn't it?
Yeah, so obviously there's still some more to play out in terms of the party culture element, but I think they'll be really pleased, especially given Bridges' rating.
What does it do for him?
Well, you know, we're moving into Christmas and he's got some time to reflect. And you know, I mean, what we know is that the core vote for National is clearly very strong, irrespective at the moment of who their leader is. And we've talked about this before on the show, that this is very much a legacy of what Key and his government were able to build up over that 9 years, and there's some real solidity there. I do think New Zealand First won't be that worried, because their history of being in coalition has been that often when they're in partnership with governments, they tank to like 2% in the polls between elections.
They back Winston to get them back up. Yeah. Kirk, I think this poll showed actually economic optimism was up a little bit, but I wonder what impact rising rents, cost of living, petrol might have had. You know, that could be a factor.
Yeah, well, certainly I think the petrol, the fuel hike stuff is probably damaged Labor a little bit. I mean, it's obviously good news for Simon Wall. National's at 46, he's pretty safe.
You think so?
Yeah, I would think so. I do think it is that cost of living stuff, which is probably hit Labor a little bit harder than they would have hoped for.
Being at the regions, do you think Shane Jones might have been hoping for a little bit more? You know, he's rolling out a lot of money. I mean, your region will be getting some money, I presume, that he would be getting a little bit more lift for New Zealand First.
Oh, look, I'm not quite sure whether that actually reflects in the polls, but definitely for the Tairawhiti region, we've received $152 million. And we're starting to do that work program right now. And it's very important that we're actually able to perform as well. You know, you've got the $1 billion fund that the government's allowed, and then suddenly you get it landed in your doorstep, and it'd be very disappointing not to actually use it. And there's quite a bit of logistics involved. You know, you get your labour, your professionals, they need houses, and more people are coming into your district, and so logistically.
So how long will it take before you start to see the real fruits of that investment, so the extra jobs, the activity, the economic, where people can see it in their daily life, because that's when it's going to translate into polls, right?
Right, so absolutely. Average price of a house last year was $220,000. This year is $320,000. And so,
it's a mixed blessing.
It's a huge thing, isn't it? Then we're actually on the ball now, actually spending the money in the areas that they have actually given it to us for. And infrastructure is one of those key components. Bit of tourism, and then there's some business development. Also, training up our people to actually be able to be at peak performance for our region. So employment is actually...
So this stuff all sounds pretty good, Kirk, but as you mentioned, it sounds to me that Jones is going to get into trouble with these when he's giving loans to businesses. I mean, this is going to... And he's copped a bit of flack from Cameron Bagley, who's one to criticise him in a story tonight. This must be a risky area for him.
Yeah, well, both financially and from a political perspective, you know. And that's, I think, the biggest challenge. You know, when you're doing big-scale infrastructure projects, there are other challenges, like ensuring that you've got enough skills to be able to deliver that.
Because why can't Westland get this loan from a normal bank or an investor like other businesses?
Well, I mean, I think Jones's argument was possibly a fair one. I mean, you think about the role that Westland might play and Westland Milk might play in the Westland economy. It employs 430 people. Like you say, $636 million of turnover. You think that they should be able to get a bank loan, but if they can't, then does the government have a valid role to play given the size and scale of the organisation for that area? And I think his answer was probably.
Jennifer, what do you think of, I mean, Jones is, you know, we've talked about this before, he's a bombastic character, but I mean, when he wades into Christopher Luxon, is that a positive for him in terms of his, you know, the government, or is it a negative? I mean, he's not actually delivered any results on it. It's not like New Zealand has suddenly gone back to the regional route that it was doing.
No, I mean, I think this has always been New Zealand First's trademark, is this sort of rhetorical populism, if you like. In the process of talking about that, he's talking about the regions. And I think what we have to realise here, even though we're not seeing it in the polls yet around the fund, is that this is where New Zealand First want to be. They want to be talking to the regions.
Good or bad, it gets it discussion.
Yeah, and there's only three rural or regional provincial seats that belong to Labor. All the rest belong to National. And if we look, and when New Zealand First was at its heyday, when they got 8.5% in 2014, there were nine rural and regional provincial electorates where they clocked more than 4,000 votes, and they're all National electorates. And so what they're trying to do, I would imagine, is wean some of the National vote off into their party vote, and this could happen. It won't happen now, and it won't be reflected in the polls, but this is the kind of party they're positioning themselves
as. And it's interesting where they've been positioning themselves, because we saw with the employment law concessions that they got out of Labor, that they're positioning themselves as that, I guess, handbrake on Labor moving too far to the left. Mm. Capital gains tax, Kirk's a bit tricky for you on the tax working group. But
sounds sad, thanks.
But clearly, that is an interesting, that issue, and whether Labor can progress it, would like to have New Zealand First support, but that's a big bit of leverage, isn't it, for New Zealand First?
Yeah, I would have thought so, and they quite rightly want to play it pretty carefully, I would have thought, because they won't want to go too soon and say what their position is either, because then they lose that leverage. But it'll be a really, really critical issue going to the 2020 election. Labor clearly want to, if they're going to do it, they want to make sure that they can do it before the election so people have clarity and certainty. That's if. There's a little bit to play out on that one.
I mean, what businesses in the regions, how are they feeling? We know business confidence has been weak. What sort of a mood are your businesses got?
Well, I talk to businesses all the time, and they actually feel that there is hope now. And so people are starting to dream, and they're actually...
When did they think there wasn't hope?
When our roads turn to slush, they worry about the air services. I mean, now we have to go, if you have a meeting in Wellington, you're going to fly from Wellington to Auckland to Gisborne. We used to have regular flights from Wellington to Gisborne and back. It's really business confidence comes from government policy. So if government are positive, we feel positive as well, because they have a big part to play. FTAs, free trade agreements with China, 60-70% of our produce is actually exported to China. So they love our produce, but we just need to actually make sure that we actually ensure that policy is confident, government is confident between the countries, and so that we can actually continue to grow and prosper and invest directly. I mean, this is not just all PGF. I mean, there's a lot of private investment actually happening in our district at the moment.
Well, a quick comment about China before we go to the break. Rodney Jones, his key theme was that we just sort of overreacted to this Huawei thing and thought that, oh, goodness, China's going to cut our trade ties. What did you think, Jennifer?
Yeah, he had a fairly moderate, nuanced position that I suppose it's quite refreshing, rather than he wouldn't call it panic, but it does sort of, you know, some of the commentary has been that. I think what was interesting was his comment about we need to be independent. And we need to take back our independent foreign policy and own it more explicitly, because there's been an assumption that our closeness to China reflects independence just of the US. It's been treated in a very kind of binary way when actually the region is far more diverse, and he made that point really well.
Is business worried? Is business worried that this relationship will actually hit the Fonterra, for example, Kiwi fruit, all of a sudden a couple of trays, million trays get held up at the border?
Yeah, I think that's probably the really, really critical issue, is where there are, you know, the non-tariff barriers and the regulatory issues that are happening behind the border. As a result of what he was describing as our kind of uncertain messaging, I think we have to be very, very clear about our messaging in relation to China to make sure that those flows continue to occur for regions like Ming's. I would say it's really interesting how the UK has treated Huawei. You know, they are part of the Five Eyes. They have Huawei as their provider for their network services for 4G. And the way that they did that is they have a separate independent centre that oversees, from a cyber perspective, to manage the network. And the head of their national cybersecurity is on that. So they manage it. They manage to do that.
But that would be a huge resourcing issue for us, though, wouldn't it? For us to do
that? Yeah, but I mean, think about it. You're part of the Five Eyes.
Yeah.
You know, you should be able to manage that. And if you can leverage off what the UK have done, you know, there could be a pathway through that. And I think you saw maybe a little bit of that.
It's not over yet.
From Little, yeah.
I mean, what have you made of the debate around this? Is it, as Rodney Jones suggests, a bit of an overreaction? People have got a bit overwrought?
Well, in most cases, you sort of like look at the history and you say, well, has there been proof of actually spying? You know, you've had your own government actually have its own department spying on our citizens at one stage without authority. So we just need to make sure that we deal with facts. And Deng Xiaoping said, doesn't matter whether the cat is black and white, as long as it can catch mice. So in terms of like 5G, if it's going to be better for our country and it happens to be the Huawei system and it has to be faster and greater, because in the Tai Nga Whetū, we're actually trying to encourage more tech firms to be innovative and it's based in Gisborne itself, and you know, Straker Translation Services have moved some of them along. So make sure that we're dealing with facts rather than emotions or fear of Chinese people.
Very good. All right. Thank you very much, panel.